Good morning, church. We're so glad you're here, and we're also glad that we get to lead worship this morning. So would you stand with us and join us in a time of worship? We're starting with this song called Thrive, and no, it's not about us, but it is all about what we do here at Thrive and what we do believe in and want for our students. And so, yeah, feel free to put your hands together and let's sing along.
Good morning. Welcome to our gathering this morning. It was so awesome this morning at 9:30. We had people in the balcony. The pews were looking full down here, and it's this sign of hope that we are gathering together. We want to welcome you, welcome our online viewers as well, and glad that you can be a part of our morning together. It's so awesome to be together, and I always remind myself that we were built to be seen and loved as God purposely places us in community. And this is a place where community happens, and I'm so thankful for that here in Hepburn. We're excited to have our students and our staff here from Thrive today. They're going to be leading us in worship, sharing a little bit about what's happening in their lives, and also hear from God's Word. So thank you, Thrive, for being here and participating this morning. I want to highlight a few church announcements. The first one is with regards to our Easter art project. Some of you maybe have seen these in the last few Sundays with a description of an invitation to your creative side for Easter Sunday. If you want to participate and don't have one with the explanation, there are some on the way out and you can grab one. And those are due next week. So make sure it's all sorts of creativity. I'm still contemplating what I can do because I feel like I lack in that department. So we'll see what comes to mind, or maybe I'll just enjoy those of you who are very creative. Next Sunday, we will be having a family service at our 9:30 service, and that's kind of geared towards families with pre-K and elementary kids, although all ages are welcome if that suits you better, and the focus will be on Palm Sunday. And we want you to get excited about coming. Feel free to invite family and friends to join as we are allowed to have more people in this space. I also wanted to highlight that on March 29th, it's next Monday, there will be a worship night held here. Luke Martins and Greg Clausen will be planning that, and an email will come out with regards to registering for that event. So mark that on your calendars. And I also wanted to congratulate Andrew and Kristen on the birth of Miles Everett. I have a little bit of a bias because he's my grandson, but this is the first time he's been in church, so they're here this morning, and we welcome you here as well. Before we continue to worship in song, I want to briefly highlight a few things that we as a Thrive board and along with our staff are excited about what's happening in the last few months. First of all, despite COVID restrictions on some of our programming, we are still grateful for the variety of experiences and modules that have been offered to our students this year as we strive to develop whole and holy disciples. When I hear stories of how students are engaging in classes and on campus and in community, they're seeking truth and they're maturing in their faith, and that makes me very excited. I told the people in the first service, I get goosebumps when I hear these stories. And I long to see young adults building a firm foundation in their faith to help prepare them for life beyond Thrive and to make an impact in this world for the glory of God. And that's what we are called to be, whether it's in their future workplace or their community or relationships or the broader church or going off to university or college. That's our desire for them. We want them to thrive, just like the song that we sang this morning, like a tree planted by waters and thirsting for God and filling us up and then overflowing out of us and shining like the sun. That's just makes me so excited about the desire that we have for these students. As a board, we're extremely thankful to our Canadian conference who have encouraged and supported us in the partial sale of the Bethany campus. And because of this transaction, Thrive is able to stay here in Hepburn. And that excites us. We have the opportunity to own the South Dorm that is on a separate parcel of land. And we appreciate the engagement of various supporters as well as our conference. We truly see this whole transaction is a miracle, and we are encouraged to continue offering an amazing discipleship program right here in Hepburn. And the other exciting news is that we have 11 registrations already for fall, which is far beyond what we usually have in March, especially in these early years of building the program. And so we're just excited, and now that we know we get to stay in Hepburn, now the recruitment process can just go into full force. So we praise God for that. We're also very thankful for our staff. They are passionate to serve and mentor our students. They go above and beyond. They put in a lot of overtime, And I believe it's because they see the need of our, of these young adults, and they see the fruits of their labor. And I just am so thankful that they're willing to be a part of what is happening there. We're so blessed. We have great staff and students, and I'm so thankful for that. God is very good. He is very good. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, you are a good God, and we just gather together today to lift your name on high, because your name is above every name, and we're here today to worship you. May we shine in this dark world and reflect you. And Jesus, as we cling to the faith and love and grace that spring from the hope that's only in you, may we truly know you and bear fruit. I pray that you fill us with understanding and wisdom as we seek you. And may we live a life worthy of you, being strengthened with your power, so that we may have great endurance and patience as we run this race that you've set before us. Lord, we thank you for making yourself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, humbling yourself, and being obedient to death on a cross to rescue us from our sins. And then rising again on that third day and giving us the hope of eternal life with you. What a great reward. You are the everlasting God, and we worship you. Amen.
Before we continue worshiping, I'd like to introduce my team here. So that's Damien on vocals, Brianna on vocals, Abby on keys and vocals, Alex on guitars, and Matthew on bass, and I'm Sheba. And so yeah, would you stand with us and worship the Lord?
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Thank you.
So much, and let me see it.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Daryl Balzer, for those of you that don't know me, and I'm the president of Thrive here out in Hepburn, and I have a couple of great young students with me here. Dennis is from Calgary, and Alicia from Rostern. And bear with us, because I'm really nervous. They're not, but I'm super nervous up here. So But we had a rehearsal this morning in the first service, and it went quite well. So I'm just going to ask these guys some questions and let them share about what's going on in their lives here at Thrive. So Dennis, before Thrive, give us an idea of your journey sort of leading up to your decision to come.
One day, I felt something inside calling me to go to a church that I had gone to youth group at a few years earlier, and it was there that I met Luke Martins, who was living in Calgary at that time, and we started to get to know each other, and in June of 2020, he told me about this program called Thrive in his hometown, and he thought that I would be a really good fit for it, and as soon as I read the information that he sent me, I had an overwhelming sense of certainty and peace that I would be moving to Saskatchewan the following September. At first, I didn't think too much of all of this, but looking back on it now, I can definitely see how God was leading me to where he wanted me to be.
Awesome. And same question over to you, Alicia. So tell everyone a little bit about your journey as you came to the Thrive beforehand.
Before coming to Thrive, I was not in a great spot mentally or with my relationship with God. I was not enjoying life very much, and I wanted more than anything to be out of high school. I struggled a lot with trying to figure out what career I wanted to go to school for. So I decided I wanted to go to Bible school for a year, especially since I knew my relationship with God was suffering. I knew I struggled a lot with opening up to people, so I looked for a smaller school where I would not feel so overwhelmed with being around a lot of people. I looked into many Bible schools, but Thrive was the only one that gave me any sense of peace, so I finally decided to apply. There were many things in my life that I can see that God had used to lead me to Thrive. But the one in particular was when my family and I moved to Ontario to the Youth Farm Bible Camp in Saskatchewan 5 years ago. If we would have had ignored God's calling and not moved, I would have not been introduced to Thrive through the Youth Farm, and I would not be here today. It's just crazy to think back to how terrible the idea of moving was to me 5 years ago, and how God took that and he turned it into something amazing, and that I get this amazing opportunity to be here.
Awesome. Okay, back to you, Dennis. So now, thinking about currently, what has sort of been going on inside of you, or what has God impacted you with during your time here at Thrive?
Well, at the beginning in September, I felt like I wasn't a whole person. I felt very broken up emotionally. But since I have been at Thrive, I've felt Jesus sort of pull me back together, and I'm now a whole person, and I know who I am through Jesus. And my faith has grown like crazy since I've been here. In September, when I first walked through the doors, I really wanted to believe in the Bible and in Christianity, but I just didn't have enough information, and with the culture around me in Calgary, I had it basically chalked up to a fairy tale that some people needed to believe to get through their day. However, after taking classes on theology, apologetics, Old Testament and New Testament history, and many others, I feel like I'm standing on a rock in what I believe, rather than sinking in quicksand.
Awesome. And same for you, Alicia. How about what's God been showing you or teaching you or doing inside of you during your time?
Being here at Thrive has been the best year of my life and nothing that I could ever imagine. All my life, I hardly had any friends and was bullied for so many years that I built this huge wall around myself and was so insecure. Coming to Thrive, God had shown me in many ways how to break down that wall that I never thought would be possible to do. He also gave me not just one friend, but a whole family that I never thought I would ever get, who love me and show me how a real friend treats you. I grew up in a Christian home, and coming to Thrive, I thought I knew a lot about God, but taking these classes and being here has shown me that I've only scratched the surface, and there's so much about God that I don't know. My faith has been strengthened in so many ways, and my relationship with God is better than it has ever been.
Awesome. Okay, so last thing, as you look now, we're in the last month, look into the future, what's God been showing you, or how are you approaching your next steps because of God?
I don't know exactly what I'm going to do. I don't know if anybody knows exactly what the next steps are ever, but I know that I feel a huge passion inside of me for sharing what I've learned from my time at Thrive with anybody willing to have a conversation about it. And I do feel like eventually I will end up in some kind of ministry leadership position. I don't know how I'll get there, but I know that if that's what God wants me to do, he will get me there somehow.
Awesome. And Alicia, same question. The scary future awaits you in a month or so. And what is God teaching you there or showing you, or how are you approaching it differently?
To be honest, the future does scare me. And the closer the end of Thrive gets, the more scared I become. I have no idea what to do as a career yet. And the thought of having to leave this amazing family behind hurts. I thought that leaving Thrive would mean I'd be downgrading back to my old life and the way I was living a year ago when I was in high school. But these past few weeks, God has been taking that idea I have and flipped it around and showed me how I should view it. He taught me that in order for him to do amazing things in my life, I have to leave this chapter in my life, just like if I had not left my chapter back in Ontario, I would not be here today. Even though it will be hard to be back at home, I am not the same person that I was before, and even though physically it may look like my old life, internally I am a new person, and I can have a whole new attitude and perspective on life. And I can allow God to use this time at home to prepare me for what he has planned for my life. God showed me that he has me in the place I am for a reason, and being at home means he needs me there for a reason, and the only thing I can do is trust him. Being at Thrive has given me this new perspective on life, and that being in a life with God will never be boring, even if I can't see the future.
Awesome. Well, that's it. Good job, guys. Thanks for sharing. Isn't that super encouraging to hear from the actual students that are going through the program? I'm so blessed to get a front row seat at seeing the transformation that happens during their time here at Thrive. So, we're going to move now to the message, and the title that I've given it this morning is called Risky Disciples, and that kind of has a weird ring to it, but we're going to learn through Hebrews what that really means. But before I get started, I'd like to just open up with prayer. Magnificent Holy Father, we come to you this morning in awe of you and needing you and loving you and wanting more of you. And God, I just ask for your help during this message, that you would put words in my mouth and they would be yours and they would be true to your word. And Lord, I just pray that you would open hearts and eyes this morning to free us to see what you would have our lives look like here on earth and all that we have ahead of us in you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to be looking in your Bibles at Hebrews chapter 10, and we're going to look at four passages, chapter 10, 11, 12, and 13. But like I said, I called this message Risky Disciples because it's what I hope that our students at Thrive become or grow into. I know that the time at Thrive is only a short 8-month season of their life, and God does lots beforehand and obviously is going to do lots more after that, but I hope they just catch this glimpse of what it would be like to live for him in a risky sort of way. And you might be asking me, why would you want to risk? Why would you want to live like a risky life as a disciple of Jesus? In our society, risk is something we typically avoid. But when we look at the Bible and we look at the characters in the Bible, we see people after people being called by God and taking massive risks when they answer him. I mean, Noah, do I have to explain? He built an ark before it had ever rained for 100 years. And he obviously got a lot of ridicule for that. Abraham, he picked up his whole family. He was wealthy and established, and he picked up his whole family and left out of faith. I mean, it wouldn't have made sense to anybody around him. Gideon, he led a small group of people against a massive army. I mean, he did something that nobody would think was realistic. Even he didn't think it. Esther, she spoke to the king and risked her life for her people. Moses, he left the king's castle. He was at the richest place in the world. He could have had anything he wanted, and he left for his people. The list goes on. Daniel, David, Joseph. Everybody we see in this Word of God lived in such a way that didn't make sense. They must have been thinking about something else other than their immediate surroundings or what the culture of the day would have said they should do. But if you don't think that's enough reason, I'm just going to go into more of why I want to help our students, and even us today become risky disciples of Jesus. So my desire and prayer is that we would live lives that have this radical risk-taking flavor to them, that we would almost have this courageous countercultural flavor to us that makes the average North American person a little uncomfortable. I ask our students, have you at any point felt uncomfortable? I hope so this year. We want that. Uncomfortableness, good. My desire and prayer is that your life would have a call on it to something more, something maybe dangerous or salty, something unusually joyful when suffering comes. Jesus talks about being the salt and light in Matthew 5 of the world. But right before that, in his sermon, he says, "Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice, be glad, for your reward is great in heaven." And that's right before. Then he says, be salt and light. And I think that is basically his definition of salt and light. My desire and prayer is that Thrive students and us live in such a way that over several years, maybe the church you attend and the people that encounter you regularly become like this. They see this in you and they become salty. They may be counted all joy when they walk through trials of various kinds. Crazy people that meet cancer head on, suffering or tragedy with unwavering confidence in Christ and in joy in being known and loved by him. That there is a great reward coming, and we're going to see that in Hebrews. My desire and prayer is that our students would live a life of laying up treasures in heaven and not pursuing stuff. That they would flee the pursuit of riches, of fleeting pleasures of the world. 1 Timothy 6:9, Paul says, "Those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction." Folks, the world is not going to glorify Christ because they see that Christians are healthy and wealthy and prosperous. Why? Because that's what they live for. They're not impressed by us Christians who are pursuing the same thing. Maybe we have Jesus as our way, but they just have their own way. It's not going to impress anybody out there. We live our lives sometimes like Jesus is the ticket, and when the show starts, you throw the ticket away. Well, they don't need your ticket because they have a different ticket that gets them to their show. They're not impressed by that kind of thing. So it's no different than what they are pursuing. It's just another way. Nobody's going to be impressed by our students if they just simply live a prosperous, wealthy, safe, middle class, do what everybody else does life. I want those who don't know Jesus to be really impressed with them, with what they see in them, their saltiness, their risky, sacrificial lives for something different than what everyone else is looking for. Howard Guinness wrote a little book called Sacrifice in 1939, and here's a quote from it. It says, "Where are the young men and women of this generation who hold their lives cheap and be faithful unto death, who will lose their lives for Christ's, flinging them away for the love of him? Where are those who will live dangerously and be reckless in this service? Where are the men of prayer? Where are the men and women who count God's word of more importance to them than their daily food? Where are the men who, like Moses of old, commune with God face to face as a man speaks with his friend? Where are God's men and women in this day of God's power?" That is a convicting quote, and I think it holds true today. If you're still not convinced that we're called to live a risky life, I want to take you through a couple passages that speak exactly to suffering. Jesus said that if you're serious about him, you will suffer. Not maybe. Luke 9:23 says, "Deny yourself and take up your cross." That was a death instrument. There's no way around it. It's nothing else but a death instrument. Matthew 10:25 says, "If they called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? John 15, Jesus said, if they persecute me, they'll persecute you. Luke 21 says, you will be hated by all for my name's sake. These are all direct quotes from Jesus. Is it just Jesus? Paul says the same thing. He took Jesus' teachings and made it the foundation for how he created disciples. He tells everyone that through many tribulations, you must enter the kingdom of God. Not optional. There's no other way in. That's Paul's basic discipleship 101. 2 Timothy 3:12 says, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Peter also, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. So, Jesus, Peter, Paul, Hebrews, all bear witness to the fact that followers of Jesus will suffer. I don't think I want to escape from that number. There's a song that has this line in it that says, must I be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas? I want that answer to be no. I don't want that to be me. So the question remains, how? What makes people, like we read about in Scripture, do this crazy, risky, suffering lifestyle for Jesus? What creates a life, a ministry like this? Maybe you're out there and you're a Christian and you're just sensing, maybe I wouldn't mind that. How does it happen? I want more of that. How do I get that? Well, let's turn our attention to Hebrews for some more answers. Now, Hebrews, we're going to go to chapter 10. Hebrews is thought to be the only sermon given to believers in the entire Bible. All the other sermons, like in Acts, were given to largely non-believers. But this one is clearly to people who believe in Jesus. Not only that, but it is considered a sermon because it's called a word of exhortation. And if you read it from start to finish, it will take you just under an hour, which by first century standards would be a very average, normal sermon. Don't worry, I know we're not in the first century. I will not get this any longer than 30, 35 minutes. So that's what we're looking at in Hebrews. We're looking at the end of a sermon to believers. Let's go to chapter 10, verse 32 to 35. It says, but recall the former days when after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. What is the reward? That doesn't sound, I mean, this doesn't take any professional to tell you guys what it's saying in here. It was the new Christians, they'd become Christians, and they were living in a time where you got persecuted. Like, you got mistreated, you got thrown in jail, and then it talks about those that went to visit their family in jail were basically announcing they're Christians, therefore they knew they were coming home to their property being plundered. They willingly left, knowing when they came back it was going to be a disaster. And they were joyful? How? How were they joyfully accepting the plundering of their property? It says here that they knew they had a better possession. And the writer of Hebrews encourages them, don't throw away your confidence. It has a great reward. I've heard the statement, I'm sure everyone maybe has, you're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. Well, I propose a different way of saying that. I say we are only any earthly good if we are so heavenly minded that we are free from this world, free from stuff that kills us, phones, cars, trips, the list goes on. These people were free from their stuff. They were so free, it's like they just, they were acting as though tomorrow they had this inheritance, even though they could have lived another 80 years. But they were living their life as though, I just have to make it till tomorrow and I have this great reward. These people are crazy. They just are. But I want to know what that reward is that made them act that way. Just the next chapter, Hebrews 11, verses 24 to 26. It says, let me find it, by faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Again, what is the reward? I spoke about it earlier. We know Moses. He was adopted into the richest family, the most powerful family. He had it made. And he left. He couldn't stand the sight of his people being mistreated, and he took action. And it says here that he chose that. But he was also looking to the reward. What is the reward? One more. Hebrews 12:2. Looking to Jesus, now we're speaking about Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. What is the joy that was set before him? Even God, Jesus, he used what was set before him as a motivation or a way of navigating what was just ahead of him, which was the shame of the cross, the abuse, the betrayal, the beating. He looked at the joy that was set before him so that he could endure it. This is a model for us. If the Lord is okay with looking ahead to the reward to help him through today, then I'm thinking it's okay for us to do that. I'm thinking this is how we get sanctified. We think about what's ahead of us, and it helps us through today, whatever that looks like. Or it helps us take crazy risks for him, because we know that in the end we have a great reward. Now, if you're not there right now, and you're thinking, why am I not like that? Why don't I feel that? Why am I not looking to the reward? I am not saying to anybody here that feels that way that they're not a Christian, that they're not a believer. And I'll tell you why I can back that up in Ephesians 1. This is a very important chapter, and it's Paul writing to believers, and he's praying for them. It says, Paul's prayer is to have their eyes open to the hope that they are called to. He prays that the glorious riches of their inheritance would be open to them. And he prays that their eyes would be open to the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe. So Paul must think that there are believers out there that need prayer to have their eyes open to this amazing inheritance that we will have. So all we need to do, you guys, is get on our knees and do some heart work and ask God to reveal to us our future. Ask him to show you the great reward. And finally, the last passage in Hebrews, in the final chapter, one of my favorites, Hebrews chapter 13, 12 to 14. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. Why? For here we have no lasting city. We seek the city that is to come. What is the city that is to come? What an awesome picture of Jesus. You see physical pictures of Jesus, and it's talking about the same thing here. He went outside the gate to bear the reproach for our sins, and it's calling us to go outside the gate as well. Now, if you know, cities back in those days mostly had walls around them, and they did have a gate, and you didn't go outside the gate after a certain time. You went outside the gate for a specific purpose, but there was danger out there. There was animals. There was other people that were out to get you. There was risk. And then for Jesus, there was Golgotha, where he went to be crucified. So this is, but that, in our day, what is your gate? What is outside the gate for you? Maybe it's your next door neighbor who you can't even bear the thought of having a conversation with. Maybe it's your coworkers, your classmates, your future encounters. Maybe it's missions, but it doesn't have to be. Our missions can be in our backyard. Maybe that's your outside the gate. It's not going to be easy. But who is out there? It says Jesus went outside the gate. Let us go to him. Folks, there is so much. And then it says, "Here we." Why would you do that? Because here we have no lasting city. And when I think of our cities here and our buildings, and I think of Mosaic Stadium, which I know that some of you will have a warm, fuzzy feeling right away when you think of the Riders playing at Mosaic Stadium. And I can tell you, I've had the privilege of walking into the Sky Dome and seeing and playing there and looking around from on the field and just being blown away by the magnitude of these buildings. And it says in Scripture that not one brick will be left on top of another. So why are we living for it? What in the world? Why are we living for it? We seek the city that is to come. So, like I said, these verses are fairly straightforward. I think they all speak to a reward, a joy, a city that is to come. And they help us understand what it must take to live a risky, sacrificial life for Jesus. So I ask you guys, what does the verse 13 mean for you? Where is that for you? I'm praying that our students feel that question during their time here at Thrive, especially in the last month, as they have potentially a long life ahead of them. I hope they're saying to themselves, I'll go anywhere for the reward of Christ, for the glory of God. If any of you are hearing this and you hear a whisper inside of you saying, I want that, Lord, where should I go? You don't need to worry. Our Lord is not going to call you outside the gate and leave you hanging and not knowing what to do. He's not sitting on a throne pointing to you, go out there and do what I say to do outside the gate. He's already out there and he's saying, come to me. He's saying, come to me. He's out there in the trouble, and he's bidding you to come. So in all these texts, the structure of the argument is the same. The way God creates radical sacrifice is the same. When we treasure our true reward way more than we treasure this world, whether that's our family, our wives, our husbands, our kids, our comfort, our riches, our trips, our property, if we treasure the reward 1,000 times more than that, we will understand what taking risks means and how easy it can be. There aren't many like this in our world, in our Western culture. There are not many like this who live this way. In other parts of the world, there are. When you become a Christian in another part of the world, you sign up right that day for persecution. You might not even be able to go home to your family. So you're signing up for it. But here, you can sign up, put your name on the Christian list, and sit in the pew for 50 years and do nothing. It's easy. It's easy to fake it. Just ask me. So what is the great reward? The last bit of the sermon here, we're going to spend some time answering that. What is the joy set before us? What is the city that is to come? The answer is simply the preeminence and the supremacy of Christ, experienced as your complete joy of your life forever. The book of Hebrews spells it out. He is supreme, glorious, and precious, and he is that reward. Now, those of you who have studied more than I have will maybe think, wait a second, Hebrews is all about Christ being the means to the end, the way we get to heaven, our pathway to get to the city that is to come. He's the means. He helps us. He's very valuable, and we need him for forgiveness so we can appear before God. And it says stuff like that in Hebrews. It calls him the interceding high priest. It refers to him as purification for our sins, the founder of our salvation, the perfecter of our faith. So how am I getting this, that he is also the reward and not just the means to the reward? Well, here I want to make this claim to you. And I look at these pictures, and we're coming up on Easter, and I just want to say to you that at the moment that Jesus was on the cross, dying, pouring out his blood for us, he became and displayed the supreme beauty of the glory of the grace of God, which we were all created for our eternal joy. So what I'm saying is, in his means work, the work that he's doing to get us to the end, he becomes our end. He is the clearest image of the end for which we are made. I want you guys to look at Ephesians 1, homework for our students. You guys, it's optional. This afternoon, read Ephesians 1 slowly a couple times. It says we are made to praise the glory of the grace of God. And this grace, I would argue, reaches its peak in the display on the cross, the moment his blood is poured out, that sinners might be freed from their love affair of the world and enjoy him in this display of free grace forever. You guys, we think about heaven and we forget sometimes that heaven is Jesus. It says in Revelation 5 that the elders see a lamb standing there as though it had been slain. And the lamb takes the scroll, and it's the only one worthy to open it. And when he does, the elders fall down and they sing a new song saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God." And then, a few verses down in Revelation 5, it goes on and it emphasizes it again. "Then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.' And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, 'To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever.'" Folks, we won't be putting that behind us. We will not get to heaven and forget about Jesus who was slain and just that was a moment in time to get us here. That is heaven. We will be singing that song for eternity. Our reward is, there's nothing beyond that. Are we going to just hurdle over Jesus to see more of our stuff, to get to the city? Are we going to leave him in the dust? No, he is the end. He is the end for which we were made. So, brothers and sisters, Jesus is not a ticket to go see a different show. He is the show. The ticket is the show. And everything in the book of Hebrews that it says about Jesus should increase our love for him. Let me recap things that it says about Jesus in the book of Hebrews. He is God's final revelation. He is the heir of all things. He is the creator of the world. He is the radiance of God's glory. He is the exact imprint of God's nature. He upholds the universe by the word of his power. He made purification for sins. He sits at the right hand of the majesty on high. He is God enthroned forever with a scepter of uprightness. He is worshiped by angels. His rule will have no end. His joy is above all other beings in the universe. He took on human flesh. He was crowned with glory and honor because of his suffering. He was the founder of our salvation. He was made perfect in all his obedience by his suffering. He destroyed the one who has the power of death, the devil. He delivered us from the bondage of fear. He is merciful and faithful high priest. He made a propitiation for sins. He is sympathetic because of his own trials. He never sinned. He offered up loud cries and tears with reverent fear, and God heard him. He became the source of eternal salvation. He holds his priesthood by virtue of an indestructible life. He appears in the presence of God on our behalf. He will come a second time to save us who are eagerly waiting for him. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. All this supremacy of Christ is poured into one word, him. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. So in conclusion, when he bids us to leave the securities and comforts of life and take up a radical, risk-taking, sacrificial way of life, it is not a path we take alone. Jesus is outside the camp in a way that he's nowhere else. Like I said, he's not telling us to go. He's asking us to come. Come to me outside the camp. So, the glory of Christ is not just his perfect fitness to bear our sins, and it's not just a supremely valuable future that we all have if we trust in him, but his supremacy is also our present treasure now. We don't have to live our lives just for the future. He is our treasure. We have it now. And he's there outside bidding us to come. Some of you will know who have suffered greatly in this world that the sweetest fellowship with Jesus you will ever know is the fellowship of his sufferings. So I say it one more time. My desire and prayer to God for Thrive students and for us is to live our lives and have a ministry that is radical, risk-taking, and has a sacrificial flavor. Let us go to him outside the camp, for here we have no lasting city. We seek a city which is to come. And his builder is God, and the light is the Lamb, our Lord Jesus. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, the Lamb who was slain, we worship you now, and we ask you to create in us a desire for you that outweighs anything in our path here on this earth. We ask you to create in us this love for you and anticipation of the reward, which is you, so much so that others are impacted by us and that they see our decisions, they hear our words, and they can't help but be amazed at how we live here on this earth because of you. I pray all these things in your precious holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Daryl, and your students for serving this morning. A reminder to be risky disciples for Jesus and to go through the gate. And just a great reminder to me, as it's very easy to get very comfortable in my space. Thank you for joining us this morning in worship. We're just a small group. You can exit out this way as time allows, and remember to social distance. There's also space on the parking lot that you can visit. And we also have the Easter Art Project frames if you want to grab one on your way out if you need one. And there's also an offering box there that you can utilize if need be. So have a wonderful week and enjoy the spring weather.